They've asked me to take my hijab off. As Muslim women, it's part of our honor. I've been made to feel like a criminal, even though I haven't done anything wrong. You might think it's not going to happen to you, and because I didn't think it was going to happen to me, and it did. I was coming back from a trip with my son, and the police were waiting for me outside the plane. And I remember thinking, I don't know what the problem is because I haven't done anything wrong. And this is the first time that I've been stopped. So they've asked me to follow them to a room. They were asking me about what I've done in the UK from when I started working, different places that I've lived, and also when I went abroad, what I did. They moved on to asking me about people and if I know them and, you know, their names and things like that. About halfway through the interview, they've asked me to do a DNA test. They've got two ladies that came in the room. They've asked me to take my hijab off after they've got me to sign the paper with this small writing. And no one explained to me why I had to take my hijab off. I remember feeling like I'd been made to feel like a criminal, even though I haven't done anything wrong. And they were saying that I wasn't under arrest or anything like that. And they just wanted to speak to me. But it just felt humiliating. I felt that I've been dishonored because obviously my hijab is my pride and it's an act of worship. And I didn't understand what that had to do with me being questioned for anything and being questioned for 6 hours until 2 o'clock in the morning. It wasn't really the best situation to be in. And so it was hard to actually understand why I had to go through all of that. And after 6 hours, okay, you can go home now. Nothing was achieved from that at all. I've been wearing hijab for as long as I can remember, and it's my identity, it's my choice, it's an act of worship. And for me, and I'm wearing hijab because my creator has told me to. Nobody had forced me to actually take the hijab on. So for me to actually be asked to take it off was humiliation, dishonor. You can tell me at one hand that actually I have the right to wear my hijab, yet you tell me when I travel, then no, that right is taken away from you. And I have challenged it through the legal system, and alhamdulillah, I'm glad I've done that. I feel it's important to challenge because hijab, it's part of our identity as Muslim women. It's part of our honor. And why shouldn't we challenge it if we are citizens and, you know, there's a rule of law that gives us the right to be able to exercise our religion? My message for the Muslim community is that, you know, you might think it's not going to happen to you, and because I didn't think it was going to happen to me, and it did. And everyone might think, oh, well, it only happens to people who have done something wrong. How about when it happens to you and you haven't done anything wrong? I urge you to actually stand up with the community who are going to do something about it and be part of this, because at the end of the day, you and all of us have, you know, to stand in front of Allah in the Day of Judgment, and we're going to be asked what we have done. So if we know injustice had taken place and we didn't do anything about it, then what are we going to say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That's what we have to understand. As Muslims, at the end of the day, we have got, you know, duty towards each other. And because of that, we have to stand up, because at the end of the day, it's affecting us, no one else. And if we don't speak up, if we don't do anything about it, I can't see anyone else outside the Muslim community who's going to come and solve this problem for us. And I went to CAGE, and they're actually the ones who provided me with the legal numbers of the people that I needed to contact regarding this issue that I've had. And CAGE had actually been supporting me for the last 2 years. And if it wasn't for CAGE, I don't know, honestly, what I would have done. You know, I can honestly say that they genuinely had helped me regardless of, you know, when I called, whenever, you know, that I needed help, whenever I needed advice, whenever I needed support. And just not just that, but also like emotional support from the sisters specifically that, you know, that I contacted. And, you know, it's not that they were my caseworkers or anything like that. I could just call and feel like, yes, they understand me, because, you know, we live in a world where, you know, nowadays, if you're a Muslim and you're kind of like associated with something, you know, that is frowned upon in the community, such as this, you know, everyone is like, oh, well, you know, it's nothing to do with me. That person must have done something wrong. But it's for your own benefit as a Muslim to be able to stand with another Muslim and support them in their time of hardship, because obviously you're going to have a different reward than the person who stood by and actually didn't do anything to help that Muslim when they were in need, because Allah is going to help that person anyway. And I can only honestly say I've got that and beyond from Cage, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, knows that. And I honestly think that, you know, if it wasn't for Cage, you know, I don't know what I would have done. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward them with Jannat al-Firdaus, and, you know, the Ummah to continue supporting them, because subhanallah, no one knows how much they do except people that they really help. And, you know, subhanallah, even if people don't say it out loud, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is hearing the du'as that they make in private for them. And inshallah, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept it from them, inshallah, and forgive them for their sins and their shortcomings, and to grant them and their families Jannatul Firdaus. And I ask the Muslim community, if you help them in any way that you can, then your reward is with Allah, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, inshallah.